Let's get out and start a fire. That can only be made too slowly. I'll say.
Guys, welcome back to the channel. Welcome to Survival Russia. We're in the forest again. We are on the way up to the snow shelter. We're gonna do an overnight. I have my backpack, my snow shovel as usual, my Siberian hunter skis, my native boots, and our beloved sled. We're not that far into the forest yet, a few hundred meters. Out there we have a logging trail. But it's a very dangerous logging trail. The reason I say that the logging trail is dangerous at the moment is, of course, that the wolves, they will travel there. That is because the snow is up to here, up to my waist. A little bit above my waist, actually. You can see, it's up to here. So the wolves will have a very hard time traveling in this snow, and they will have a very hard time hunting in this snow. I mean, this snow here is deeper than a wolf itself, and in many places it will be even deeper because of voids under the snow and blah blah blah. The moose has a huge advantage because the moose can travel in it. Whenever there's gonna be a frosty crust on the snow during spring, the wolves are gonna have an advantage and the moose is gonna have a disadvantage. So up at the campsite, I'm not really worried about wolves because they'll be traveling the logging trails and the railroads. And somebody have forgotten to tell our wolves, as many people say that wolves don't do anything to people and so on. But here they do. It's not too often, but it certainly happens. The wolves can of course travel the ski trail here, but I seriously doubt that they are gonna head up to a camp. They go to the villages and so on, see if they can catch some cats and dogs and whatnot. But wolves are certainly a concern in these conditions because they have a very hard time hunting. Alright guys, we are at the camp. Almost, we are 10-15 meters from the camp. And right here, we have what to me looks like canine tracks on my ski trail. You see right down here, you see well, I've been standing there looking, doesn't really know what to do, but it looks like it comes from in there. I have a suspicion that it's a raccoon dog. Let's see where it's been. You see we have a little bit of prints there, but most likely been a little bit weary because everything is disturbed and looked funky and so on. I haven't been around down here at the camp, I can see. Well, let's get rid of the sled and let's investigate a little bit further in the snow here. I feel like I'm totally in control. I know what's going on everywhere. I can see everything, all tracks and whatnot. That's for a different video, because many people also talk about, the raiders and with the track, you'll be calling in your killers and the campfire and blah blah. I'll dedicate a video to that because it's an interesting topic. So let's go and investigate a little bit. See, they're very small. Very small. And it comes from in there. So it came from in there, traveling the tree line here. It's not a wolf. Distance between the tracks are not very great. This is a very small animal. Let's check what's going on here. We went down here. And we went out there. To me it just looks like coon dog. But not raccoon, but coon dog. We'll see if it comes back later. But I do have a tranquilizer with me, of course. And a flashlight on it. So here's the sled. Over there we have an active woodpecker. I just stored my stuff up there on the shelter roof. But I have something down here. I have a few cool things actually. But I have two bags I want to bring to your attention. Because they're super awesome. And they are from a super awesome company called Savota. So a while ago I wrote to Savota in Finland. Finland and Finns, they're awesome. They're sort of like the Swiss of Scandinavia. I mean, if the Finns made a car, I would definitely drive a Finnish car. Because I'm sure it would be super awesome, both for the cold and everything else. And that's how it is with their stuff there. I don't want to show you all sorts of funky stuff which doesn't work, right? I said they're from Savota, just like my backpacks. And this is the 80 liter bag. This is the, I think, 30 or 35 liter bag. They're like duffel bags. And they're mega awesome. I will make a separate video on them, of course. Because they are awesome. They have lots of funky organizers, and actually this bag here I used also at the overnighters, had it standing close to the fire so the heat will radiate through the heavy Cordura 1000 nylon here, and that worked pretty well. But down here I have a lot of stuff that we're gonna need for this little overnighter here. I have my tripods, that's why I'm fumbling around with this little guy here. But here we have my Katana Boy sweater, one tripod, two tripods, an axe, mess kit. We have a candle for the shelter. We have a little bit of food there. Well, I get some tripods out. And let's get on with the overnighter here. Alright, so we are unpacking a little bit here. But to get back to the bags here, you see, I only been using the small one here. But they have shoulder straps. And they have a ton of organizers. I say I will do a video on them and show to you guys, but they are super awesome. Both the lid and the bottom has some foam insulation, and we have Velcro straps here for the organizers and all sorts of stuff. So basically you can put it on as a backpack. You can also use it as a normal duffel bag. We have a D-rings attachment here for the duffel bag strap, and we have the D-rings for the shoulder straps. Here we have some patches, Velcro patches, if you're deploying somewhere, if you're a contractor or whatnot. So yeah, I'll just bring these bags here to your attention. We will see more to them, especially when we're gonna be able to drive the tank. Anyway, there'll be links in the description to Savota and some of the online shops we sell them, Varustelika and blah 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 blah. Speaking about links in the description, there's also links in the description if you want to support the channel, of course. If you want to buy some merchandise or whatnot. Well, we of course have some stuff to do here at the campsite. And I brought with me a new axe I've made. This is not just any kind of an axe. It is an axe like the natives use, the Siberian natives. It's not only the handle which is a little bit unorthodox. It's also the axe head itself. But we'll take a look at that later. We have to clean out some snow. We have to get some firewood. Happily we do not need that much firewood. Like when we are sleeping out in the open, right? It's gonna be very interesting to see what we can get the temperature up to in there. And I have a thermometer with me, electronic thermometer. I hope the battery is not gonna die. But it has an outside temperature sensor and an inside temperature sensor. So hopefully it will work and we can see what the temperature is gonna be during the night. And it has a maximum and minimum and all that funky stuff. Eggs, so let's get some fire going. Because we need to melt some water. We need to melt some snow, of course. Snow is awesome. Snow makes an awesome sawbuck, you can say. Before the sun goes down here, I think I'm gonna try and show you a little trick. What you can do with a handsaw and an axe if you do not have access to any twigs and branches and stuff like that. So what we can do is, as you could see, we take our small saw or big saw, we just cut around, not all the way through, so we have a cut all around the circumference of the log. And we can take our eggs. And we can make some kindling. Then I learned this from myself. That's actually the truth. It works awesome. I don't remember how I taught myself this. Maybe I was making a mallet or something. Just make a lot of these guys here and you have perfect tinder. But everything as usual. And by the way, looking at the little fire here, there was one or two guys commenting on Siberian log fire, and one guy almost screaming in the comment, but is it the Siberian log fire or what? Like, just because I haven't used it for a few times, right? But one thing which is very important to learn when it comes to the outdoors, that is that there's never any rules, there's never any one technique which is always better than the other and so on. There's always variables and tra-la-la-la-la. Just a little advice, if you don't already know, always keep your axes, saws, firearms and whatnot away from the fire, because you don't want them to be exposed to heat and cold, and especially not heat on one side, cold on the other, and especially not when it comes to your firearms. I store my axes outside all year long, and so they follow the temperature of the environment, so to speak. So we have a decent little fire going. Our water is soon boiling, I think, and having the bag standing at a safe distance from the fire there, it actually works pretty darn well. They work like small super shelters, so we're gonna build up some heat inside the bags, which is nice for the cameras. And there we have some bread and stuff we don't really want to freeze up if we can avoid it. I've been, of course, sitting and watching the camp TV here, which is always awesome, but I think we're gonna try and make the ventilation hole. I've been preparing that a little bit, so let's go take a look at that. So here we have a long stick. As you can see, I've been digging down here, so we have like a horizontal wall. We will not have the hole sticking up there, for example. And I think I'm gonna put you guys and the light in here so you can check up on if I'm gonna, excuse me, be over in that corner there, and then you can tell me when we are through. Whoa, I thought we were through. We are not. Ah, that's better. Was actually a little bit different location than I thought it was. So we got the sleeping bag and the ground pad in, and a little candle, as you can see, and the thermometer. We have a sensor here. And we have a thermometer in there, up there. But it's been in the bag. Oh, let's see. It says 19.2 outside.
Well, soon we have to get to the shelter. And it's been a while since I spent time in a snow shelter. And many of you guys know But I'm not super happy about snow shelters. And rigging up the sleeping bag and all that good stuff made me fastly remember why. But anyway, it should be warmer in there than out here. I would say it's going to be minus 20 by now or something. Weatherman says 28, and another weatherman says 23. So it's going to be interesting to see what we can get the snow shelter up to. Not less than minus 10. But anyway, whatever temperature we have in there, it's going to get higher when we get in there, because we also shed some heat and stuff like that. Hopefully it's better than sleeping out here on the fire once again. As soon as it's gonna be spring. Spring's gonna start in March, but most likely until sometime in April it will still be winter for many of you guys. All right guys, so it's time to get into the shelter. I have to get in there, I have to put this block there and all that funky stuff, and that is practically impossible to do with you guys. So see you when I'm done fiddling around with this snow shelter here. We're in, and it's damp here. Oh, not damp, but you can see my breath, right? So it's gonna be interesting to see how it's gonna go. I can already see that we are up to 9.8, but it's most likely because of my breath. And outside, it's the same, of course. 18.7, yeah. But I will have to get some trousers off, and yeah, we don't have any fire in here, right? So we are completely left to our own devices with our smoky hands. That's pretty funky, I'll say. Ooh, spooky. Well, anyway, I like this type of roof here, because at least we don't have snow up on the roof as well, right? Because snow shelters, there's always snow everywhere. It's not possible to make a snow shelter without snow everywhere, on sleeping bag and this and that, and our cups and all that good stuff. I just hope that I'll not have to go out and pour water from the potatoes. That'll not be awesome. We can tempt faith a little bit and drink a cup of tea. But another not so mega awesome thing is that we have absolutely no idea what's going on outside. A snow shelter, yeah, is warmer in here than outside, but that doesn't mean it's warm, right? Oh, can we see anything from all this steam here, actually? Even if we were super cool and the shelter was like plus 2°C, which they can be, then it's not warm, right? You have to sleep in here with no sleeping bag or anything. It's possible at plus 2 or minus 1, but to sit still or stand still, if you tried it ever out on the, you know, on the street, football game, concert, whatnot, and you just stand still and do nothing for a few hours in plus 2°C or minus 1°C, then you know you're gonna start to freeze pretty well. Let's just say it like that. There's of course a nice atmosphere in here. Not that bad. And minus 8 is still better than minus 18.8. But I think it's time to get this stuff here off. Plug the entrance there and simply just get down in the bag and see how it's gonna go. How it's gonna play out. 7.9. Well, that's up there. Maybe it's a little bit colder down here. When I get the this entrance plugged up and all that good stuff.
Something really awesome just happened when I tried to block the upper hole there with the snow block, with the anorak there. The snow block just fell out and busted up into like 4 or 5 pieces or something. Happily, I have another one. I had another one. That's just a smaller one. So we have a smaller one out there. And now I took my printing tool, put it up over the door, and the wool anorak, and the entrance is basically blocked. But I'm still in the process of getting in this bag, and that just have to be right the F now. So see you. It is 6.1, 18.9. I know you guys want to see it, so let's see. 6.1, 18.9. That is what we have to work with. So maybe it's like 8 down here or something, but this should still be plenty fine for this bag here. There is one thing I'd like to mention. When I was out fumbling around with the new block there, there is a big difference between being out there and in here. To get from out there in this shirt and so on back in, it actually felt warm. So of course it's not that bad, but I just have something with snow shelters.
Good morning, guys. So this is the amount of light we have in here, and it's time to get up because my feet are relatively cold. Let's see what the thermometer says.
Oh, it's warm. Outside is 13.6. That's a little. And 8.1 in here.
For some reason, my feet got relatively cold. But it's kind of a feature of this bag here. It's very, 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 very narrow. Oh. Let's get out and start a fire.
Ah, now I know. I know why it's only 13.6. It's because the sun is shining on the sensor. Because I can see the sun is shining.
But that's the funky thing about snow shelters. As I said yesterday, you have absolutely no idea what's going on outside.
I'll just get dressed, guys. Let's head outside.
Alright, so we're outside, guys. Moving around a little bit to get the poor feet warmed up. Because the boots are, of course, also cold.
Well, this is why it's showing 13.6.
Because it's definitely colder than 13.6. 13.6 would feel like spring.
We have the temperature that says it's 12.8. This is certainly not. But let's check the minimum and the maximum. Maximum inside. Have been 5.6. The coldest in the shelter was 12.7, and the coldest outside was -25.1. Interesting.
Try and check the water. See if we can make some tea or what.
That's a little bit of ice on it. Well, it's mostly liquid.
But we're sitting here next to the fire having a super mega treat. A cup of warm water and a cookie. I have one cookie left, as I always said. When we are survival camping, cookies are of the utmost importance. Of course, just a joke. But they're nice to have. Oh, so how was the night there? It was all right, but it gotten pretty cold on the feet. And it's kind of a feature of this bag. I don't have this problem with the Canadian sleeping system, the Canadian forces, but it's also much, much bulkier. And of course it didn't help that I knocked out the door. Or smashed the door there, broke the door up in pieces. I'll show you in a second. But anyway, the anorak here was covering pretty well, but yeah, it is what it is. But shelters, I mean, I get so many comments, and I have a disclaimer here, because I'm gonna refer to some, not negative comments, I mean, it's not negative to be, you know, having lack of knowledge about something, right? But I like to comment on these comments that people make, which are not correct, right? I mean, why would I sit and comment on stuff that you guys are commenting correctly about, right? Because these people, their knowledge about the outdoors and survival, and especially shelters and so on, when I get these shelter comments when I'm laying here in minus 20 or 25 or whatever, right? They are purely theoretical, that's for sure. I mean, oh, you need mylar blankets and these small fluffy ones. No, it doesn't make a difference. I also had a comment on this shelter over there that it would work as a cold sink. I made videos about cold sinks a long time ago, and it was never close to being minus 25 in the shelter, right? So it was not a cold sink. The 12 point something minus was actually at the very beginning of when we were setting up the shelter and I installed the thermometer. But the only shelter really which will actually protect you, me, from the cold and actually hold on to some heat, that is a snow shelter. All this kind of lean-tos and this and that, they don't hold on to any heat. They don't do anything. You still have the cold coming in from outside, right? But the snow shelter there definitely has disadvantages as well, right? Because in the morning we don't have any fire going. Everything of our boots, everything is ice cold. But there's also this issue that some think that a snow shelter will itself just protect you. You will still need your sleeping bag or something, heavy blanket or whatever, because you can see spending a night in there when it's minus 25 outside and it's anything between minus 5 and minus 12.7 inside the shelter, right? And it's not good to spend 8-9 hours or whatever, 5 hours, 4 hours, basically not doing anything, physical activity. You get ice darn cold very fast. Maybe one of the better variants is actually just to dig your delves out down in the snow as is. I think we're gonna try it at some point, not for an overnight, but I think we're gonna try it, see what it feels like, because then at least you have the snow covering you everywhere, and that's how many of the soldiers on the Eastern Front during Second World War, they survived. They survived simply just in the snow. So maybe we have to try that out as well.
What an awesome day. Not a wind moving. Lots of woodpeckers in there.
Just a little reminder from yesterday. The Savota duffel bags, they are super awesome. They definitely made my trip a whole lot easier, especially when I had to pack all my stuff into the snow shelter over there. Because as you guys know, normally I just have all my stuff here in the sled, and it's super easy just to grab this guy here. But I was nowhere near filling up this 80 liter bag there, not at all. But yeah, nothing much more to say than we're gonna get out of here. I don't know, maybe we're gonna make some footage on the way out. Who knows, we'll see. But if not, then please check the links in the description. Please consider supporting the channel and all that good stuff. And until next time, get out on train, get it done, do something awesome. And see you in the next video, guys. Thank you very much for your time.